Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Our lives that is so important to us, and we ask that you would speak to us through your word today. And I pray especially, Father, for your healing and delivering power through your word today, in Yeshua's awesome name. Amen. 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 Okay, so I have another Irving story to start things out with today. Irving's Shabbat school teacher was testing the children in her class at a Messianic Jewish congregation to see if they understood the concept of getting into heaven, how we get to heaven. So she asked them, if I sold my house and my car, had a big garage sale, and gave all my money to the synagogue, would that get me into heaven? No, answered all the children. If I cleaned the synagogue every day, mowed the yard, kept everything neat and tidy, would that get me into heaven? No, said the children. Now she was encouraged. They're really getting it, she thought. Well, then if I was kind to animals, gave candy to all the children, loved my husband, would that get me into heaven, she asked. And they all answered, no. She was just bursting with pride. They really got it. Well, she continued, then how can I get into heaven? And from the back of the room, little Irving stood up and shouted back, you gotta be dead. Thank you, Lord, for laughter. So today is a very special time of the centuries. I hope most of you realize that today is the 100th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration. The Balfour Declaration was issued by the Prime Minister of Great Britain, stating that Britain, which was in charge of the present-day land of Israel, that Britain was planning to make that into a homeland for the Jewish people and to divide that section of land into a Jewish state and an Arab state. A two-state solution. And you know what? They did. So there's actually two states now. Some of you probably aren't aware of this, but there's Israel. Do you know what the other state is? Jordan. Jordan is the state that didn't exist before this happened. So there's already a two-state solution. When you hear people talk about the two-state solution to now, you know what they're talking about? A three-state solution. So that is 100 years, and also it's the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, which we can all rejoice for, but it's a little bit bittersweet because the person who brought this about, Martin Luther, as we know later in his life, turned very much against the Jewish people, and he was the cause of much persecution that we experienced after that. So a little bit bittersweet on that one. Okay, so in the Parsha, we are in a parsha called Vayera, he approached. And this is Genesis chapter 18 through 22. So I'm going to pick up about an incident that happens in this parsha, Genesis chapter 20. Then Abraham journeyed from there to the land of the Negev and settled between Kadesh and Shur. And while he was dwelling as an outsider in Gerar, verse 2, Abraham said of Sarah his wife, she's my sister. And so King Abimelech of Gerar sent for her and took Sarah. Now, God warned Abimelech in a dream not to have relations with Sarah. And the reason that he warned him was because down in verse 18, it says this, for Adonai, the Lord, had completely locked up every womb in Abimelech's household because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So Abimelech also said to Abraham in verse 10, what motivated you to do this thing? And in verse 11, Abraham said, because I thought there's certainly no fear of God in this place, so they'll kill me because of my wife. So here we have Abraham lying, and we understand that lying is a violation of God's commands, of God's laws. So in Hebrew, who knows the Hebrew word for violating God's laws? Anybody? Pesha. Pesha. Transgressions of God's laws. But of course, the Torah had not yet been given, so that's a little bit fuzzy there. But what motivated Abraham to lie? He didn't trust God to protect him. Even though, and up to this point in the account of Abraham, God had appeared to him in the form of a man, and he had appeared to him as a smoking torch. He had spoken with him. He gave him a child miraculously. He enabled him to defeat an army. He made him rich, and he cut a covenant with him. And yet, Abraham was not willing to trust God to protect him in this place. So not trusting God to protect him is a form of fear, right? Right? And fear is, in the Hebrew, who knows the word for what fear is? Anybody? I have to keep going over this. Avon. Avon is iniquity. Fear is an iniquity. It's an attitude. It's a belief. It's not an action. Okay? Everybody remember the three words? Pesha, avon, and who remembers the other one? Good. That's the toughest one. Chata'a. That's the hardest one. So that's sin. That's an unintentional sin. Sins of ignorance and sins of neglect, sins of forgetfulness. Okay, so motivated is a very appropriate word that Abimelech used here, because that's really what iniquity is. Iniquity can be the motivation for us to sin. So what is iniquity? Let me go back over this. It's, as I said, ungodly ways of thinking, beliefs, attitudes, things that we have believe that are contrary to the Bible, or things that we think that are contrary to the Bible. So let me give you a little example of how iniquity works. Imagine a single, able-bodied, retired person. They have enough pension to live on, they don't have to worry about money, and they have an apartment, and they keep to themselves. They have their groceries delivered, they like to listen to classical music, so they just listen to music, they read good books. They're never tempted to hurt anyone or steal or lie, anything like that, right? So observing that person's life, we would say, this person doesn't sin, right? And we'd be correct. Never does anything that is sinful. But what if the reason the person stays in the house and doesn't go out is because he is afraid he will be rejected? Or he's afraid of meeting strangers, or he's afraid of the unknown. Now that fear could be there from past rejections or betrayals. And what if he's bitter about those past rejections or betrayals? Bitter to those who rejected him. Bitter toward God for allowing those things to happen in his life. What is all that? The fear and the bitterness. Everybody see? That's iniquity. Okay? In the New Covenant, iniquity is spoken of a great deal, but it's not called that. Who knows what it's called? Your flesh. No, not sin. It's called your flesh, your carnal nature, your old man, the natural man. That's the iniquity. When we come to the Lord, we are taught by the world to have all of these ways of thinking that are in agreement with the Bible, right? No. We're taught to believe a bunch of stuff that's just the opposite of the Bible by our experience in the world. So we have a lot of iniquity. Our flesh is opposed to the Bible. Everybody follow me? So it's not a foreign concept at all. It's just that most people don't dig it out of the Old Testament. They just talk about it in the New Testament, because Paul talks about warring against the flesh all the time, right? And struggling, crucifying the flesh. Okay. So it's also interesting that Sarah was 90 years old when all this happened, well past the childbearing age, and yet she was so beautiful that Abimelech wanted to take her as his wife. And Abraham knew she was so beautiful that this could happen. So I just feel like the Holy Spirit wants to say to all of you ladies who are here, it doesn't matter how many birthdays you've had, you're still beautiful. You are beautiful, especially my wife. Now, interestingly, this is actually the second time Abraham lied about Sarah being his wife. Back in Genesis 12, referring to Sarah in verse 14, it says, when Abram came to Egypt, the Egyptians did see that the woman was beautiful. Indeed, Pharaoh's officials saw her, and they raved about her to Pharaoh. She was over 90 years old. So, again, he lied about it. Now, this incident with Abimelech, it ended happily. In Genesis chapter 20, skipping back to there, Abraham prayed to God, verse 17, and God healed Abimelech, his wife and his female slaves, so that they could bear children again. So this ended okay. But then we find another very interesting thing happening. Genesis chapter 26, we read about Abraham's son Isaac, or Yitzhak. In verse 7, now the men of the place asked about his wife. So he said, she's my sister. Because he was afraid to say my wife, or else the men of the place would kill me on account of Rebekah, because she's good-looking. Sound familiar? He had the same fear as his father. He suffered from the same inability to trust God for protection. It's the same iniquity. Now later in Genesis, his wife, Rebekah, encouraged her son, one of her sons, Jacob or Yaakov, to steal his brother's blessing, even though God had revealed to her that Jacob would get the blessing from God. She did it for the same reason. She didn't trust God to bless her son. She had to take it in her own hands. It was the same iniquity. And then again, further on in Genesis, Jacob was told to return to his brother Esau, who had been very angry with him. But he didn't trust that God would protect him from Esau's revenge. He was in great fear. That's when he wrestled with God. He was in great anxiety. So, does anybody see a pattern here? We see this iniquitous trait of not trusting God for protection passing down through three generations here. Now, in Exodus, God explained this generational passing down, amazingly, right in the Ten Commandments. So I'm going to read to you in the New King James Version because it's the one that says it best. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, you shall have no other gods before me. Verse 4, you shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. Verse 5, you shall not bow down to them nor serve them. So there's the command. For I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. Now, the first thing to see about this is that the use of the word fathers would also include mothers, as we saw with Rebecca. She had the same thing. And the fourth generation, that's not just parents. It's grandparents. It's great-grandparents. It's great-grandparents. So I'm going to use, as we talk about this a little more, the word forebears, so I don't have to say parents, grandparents, great-parents, great-grandparents over and over again, okay? So when I say forebears, I mean four generations preceding a person. The Hebrew word that is used here that is translated as visit is the Hebrew word poket, and it means visiting in the sense of bringing the effect of the iniquity of the forebears on their descendants. Bringing that effect on their descendants. And I chose the New King James because it translates poket as visiting. Other translations say bringing, laying, or even punishing, which I don't believe is correct. So how does this visiting manifest itself? And I see it happening in two primary ways. First of all, children will suffer hardship in their lives due to the iniquity of their parents. Does everybody see that? We see that all around us. You know that almost all the men in our prisons were raised without a father in their home. Their father deserted his family, and the sons raised without a father often get into trouble with the law. It's dramatic, the statistics. So the father's iniquity that caused the desertion, and maybe it was the mother's iniquity that drove him out, was visited upon the sons who grew up without a father. They suffer hardship. Parents often separate because of the iniquity of one or the other. What happens to the children? You all know families that are broken. The children suffer because they're raised in a single-parent home, or they're shuttled back and forth between two families, right? So we see this is how this happens. Or a parent's iniquity could cause their children, even without a broken home, to live in fear. They can be abused children. They can live in poverty because of the parent's iniquity, because the parent can't hold a job. Now here's a biblical example of this manifestation. Yaakov, he favored one of his sons. Who was the son he favored? Joseph, right. But because he favored Joseph, and that's an iniquity, favoring one child over the other, right? He favored her because he was the son of his beloved wife, Rachel. But because he favored one son over the other 11, what happened? They hated him, and they persecuted him, and eventually they did him in, almost. They tried to do him in. So you can see how the iniquity gets passed down to the children suffer. The iniquity is visited upon the children to the third or fourth generation. Everybody follow that? Second manifestation, and here's where it becomes supernatural. Children will be susceptible to whatever iniquity their forebears were susceptible to. That's what we've just seen in the patriarchs. Yitzhak and Yaakov, Isaac and Jacob, were manifesting the same fear, the same lack of trust of God that Abraham had. And not only Abraham, but Rebecca had that too. So since she had it, she was actually from the same family. It could have come down from their forebears to that family. But we also see this in other biblical accounts. David committed adultery with Bathsheba, right? What did his son Solomon do? 600 wives. Falling into that lust, which is iniquity. And we see this manifesting in our culture. Children or grandchildren of alcoholics become what? Alcoholics. Children of a parent with a bad temper oftentimes have a bad temper. Children of a parent who can't hold a job oftentimes can't hold a job. Children of a parent who's always bitter end up being bitter. Now, we can see how some of this visitation of iniquity is by example. Okay, learned behavior. The child of a bitter parent learns to be bitter when things go wrong. Things are wrong, so I'm bitter. Or the child of a bad-tempered parent learns to explode when things go wrong. Right? So you can see, you can say it's normal. You can see how that would happen, right? But sometimes it happens totally contrary to reason. So it's believed to actually be genetically or supernaturally or somehow passed down, like alcoholism. A child observing the effect of alcohol on his parents would be expected to stay away from it, right? It ruined my family. It put us into poverty. So why do we find so many alcoholics have alcoholic parents? See what I mean? An abused child, you would think, would be the last person to abuse their own children. But what do the statistics tell us? Just the opposite. Doesn't make any sense at all. Now, one thing that has thrown some light in this recently is that geneticists, scientists who study genetics, now know that our genes, we used to think our genes were just, you know, the 23 and that's it, and they're really complex. They're very complex, and that behavior and environment actually affect the genetic traits that get passed down. So if a person is an alcoholic and they indulge in alcoholism for most of their life and then they have children, somehow that can get passed down. They haven't proved it yet that it's in the genes, but somehow it gets passed down. Could just be spiritually. So here's what the Holy Spirit is saying to us today. If you have something you struggle with and you haven't been able to overcome it, it could have power over you because it is iniquity visited upon you from the third or fourth generation of your forebears. I discovered several of these in my own life. I had an ungodly attitude toward money. I was an alcoholic, and I was doing drugs. All of that was visited generational iniquity from my parents. That iniquity of my parents became my iniquity. And it visited iniquity becomes the iniquity of whoever it is visited upon. Visited generational iniquity can also be the cause of many different kinds of problems. Emotional problems, mental problems, relational problems, physical problems. Fear, worry, and anxiety, I think most of us are aware they cause high blood pressure. They can cause ulcers. It can cause relationally loneliness. I'm afraid to meet people. Bitterness. Scientists have been showing a strong connection between bitterness and cancer. Bitterness can cause depression. Anger. Anger causes aneurysms. Broken relationships. Rejection causes loneliness and depression. So we can see how this visited iniquity can be pretty serious stuff. Now, this visitation is part of God's laws of the universe. He set this up. And it is the destruction that comes from breaking his laws. It's, you could call it, the curse of the law. The curse of the law is the negative effects people experience when they disobey God's law. It's very, very simple. Now, you know, before we come down on God about this, there's the opposite of it, which is that when we obey and we do good, blessing comes down on us. So you can't have one without the other. Okay? God would not be a just God if he said, oh, I'm going to bless everything good you do, and those bad things that you do, I'll just ignore them. That would not work. So this is why it happens. So let's look now at who is subject to this visitation of iniquity or this curse. Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, we still have it up there. Go back. It was just up there. There it is. No, five. There you go. Thank you, Jerry. Okay. Let's just look at the last part of this. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third or the fourth generation of those who hate me. So, parents who hate God, that's the most clear thing here, will have their iniquity visit upon their children. Everybody see that? Okay, who hates God? Well, the narrowest view, militant atheists hate God. The guy in Igor's video, Hail Satan, right? Hate God. My parents were communists. Some of you know about this. They were communists, atheists. They didn't just think maybe, you know, there is no God. They hated God. They believed religion was what Karl Marx called the opiate of the masses. In other words, people used religion to keep the people in control, to keep people down, to keep them oppressed. So they believed God was something that people made up to justify their oppression of people. So they hated God. Now, a little broader view is people who serve gods other than the God of the Bible, they hate God. The man who said, Hail Satan, is a hater of God. A broadest view would be anyone who has rejected the God of the Bible hates God. So this means it's pretty broad. Exodus chapter 20, verse 6 says, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. So we can infer from this something else. The iniquity of parents who don't keep God's commandments will be visited upon their children to the third and fourth generation. You see the corollary there? So people who say they believe in the God of the Bible, but don't obey him, what's going to happen? Their iniquity will be visited on their children to the third and fourth generation. So we begin to see that there's a lot of visiting of iniquity going on in our world. Yes, many, many people. So the Holy Spirit wants to set people free who are listening to this from iniquity visited on you by your forebears. Things that have caused your life to be difficult, trials that you have suffered, and there's another whole side to this. Also, set your children free from the iniquity that may be getting visited on them from your iniquity or your parents' iniquity, because it keeps getting passed down. Until this cycle is broken, it keeps getting passed down. Okay? And we just read the flip side to this bad news. God promises mercy to thousands. And in other translations, it says thousands of generations of those who love him keep his mitzvot, his commandments. So before we start thinking God is a meanie about all this, what amazing grace. Iniquity be visited to four generations. What about mercy? 1,000 generations. Okay, so an idiom developed, a proverb developed in ancient Israel to describe this law of God. And it's the title of the message if you happen to look at your bulletin. Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 29. It's actually verse 28 in the Tree of Life version, because the numbering is different. But Jeremiah 31:29, the last part of it says, "The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge." Now, what does that mean, teeth being set on edge? It's what happens when you eat something very sour. Your mouth puckers up. Your teeth feel weird. I got a picture here. Next slide. There's somebody who's eaten, looks like a lemon. Sour, puckered up, right? Okay. So what does this mean? If the father eats something sour, the children will be affected by it. If the father says something good or bad, the children will be affected by it, either a curse or a blessing. And there's no way of escaping this, because this is a law of the universe. And think about this. Even people as blessed by God as Isaac and Jacob experienced this iniquity being passed down, right? I mean, these are the patriarchs. But it still worked in their lives. But Jeremiah says something very significant about this proverb. Verse 29, the whole verse says, In those days, they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten sour grapes and the children's teeth are set on edge. So he's predicting there's going to be a change here from the way things have been. From the way things were in his time, this proverb would no longer be used, meaning there would be a way to prevent the visitation of iniquity. Everybody see that? This is what he's getting at. So the question is, when will this happen? Well, he says, in those days. When are those days? We'll see in a few minutes. Here's the result of what happens when the change comes. Verse 30, but everyone will die for his own iniquity. Every man who eats sour grapes, his teeth will be set on edge. So you can see this is talking about iniquity, right? I mean, it uses the word. So in those days, the coming days, people will be judged based on their own iniquity, not their forebears. Okay? So what did he mean by in those days? Oh, we just talked about how people are still suffering from their forefathers' iniquity right now. Right? So what days is he talking about? Now here's something I found very interesting. In most Bibles, there's a break, a new heading after verse 29. So it doesn't appear to have a connection to what follows. Okay? But if you remove the break, which was inserted not by Jeremiah, but by the publishers and the editors, the verses immediately following verse 29 are God's detailed promise of the new covenant. You see the connection there? So what are those days? Jeremiah is saying, in the days of the new covenant, you will no longer use that idiom, because there will be a way to break the cycle. Everybody follow that? So let's look at it. You can look at it in your Bible. Remember, the numbering's a little different, but it's still exactly the same. When it says, the second verse of Jeremiah's there, the next verse is, behold, days are coming. This is a declaration of Adonai, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Now, I want to go through this new covenant, because I never can read this without having to like go through it, because it's so powerful. Who will the new covenant be made with? And the house of Judah. The kingdoms were divided at that time. They existed after Solomon's kingdom was divided. So basically with all the Jewish people. So the first thing about this statement is the new covenant was not made with the church. Most Christian theologians teach the new covenant was made with the church. The new covenant was made with who? Jews, the Jewish people. Gentiles, praise God, you who are not ethnically Jews, can praise God, were later grafted into Israel so they could be included in the new covenant. Verse 31. Not like the covenant I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, for they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them. It is a declaration of Adonai. So the new covenant will be different from the Mosaic or the Sinai covenant. Doesn't say it's going to replace it. Says it'll be different. Verse 32, but this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. It is a declaration of Adonai. I will put my Torah within them. Yes, I will write it on their heart. I will be their God, and they will be my people. This is this is gives me goosebumps every time I read this. Remember, this is being written 600 years before Yeshua. Torah written within them. God's people will know his word. I don't know about you, but when I gave my heart to the Lord, all of a sudden the word stuck in me. It was like I could read it and it would stick. God's Torah will be on their hearts. Well, what does that mean? When we say something is on your heart, it means you love it. We will love his word. It will be precious. We will love to obey it. How many experience that change in their lives? Verse 33. No longer will each teach his neighbor or each his brother saying, "Know Adonai," for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. It is a declaration of Adonai. All God's people will know the Father personally, not just prophets and kings and priests. This will fulfill, if you want to look it up, Joel's prophecy in chapter 2 of the Holy Spirit being poured out on all people, sons, daughters, old men, young men, manservants, maidservants. Jeremiah's prophecy here is connected to Joel's prophecy. Because putting the Torah in you and writing it on your heart and knowing God, it's all accomplished through the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, that Yeshua would send, as he promised when he went back to be with the Father. Verse 33, "For I will forgive their iniquity, their sin I will remember no more." Forgive the iniquity and the sin remembering no more is amazing. This is erasing the hard drive, right? It doesn't mean I'm just going to cover it, which is what atoning sacrifices did, animal sacrifices. It means I will remember it no more, like he says in the Psalms. I will remove it as far as what? The east is from the west. So how will iniquity be forgiven and sin remember no more? Messiah's sacrifice, which established the new covenant, will have the power to remove your sin as far as the east is from the west, to set you free from the effects of your iniquity, all your iniquity, and here's where it connects, including the iniquity visited upon you because of your forebears. The new covenant includes deliverance from the visitation of generational iniquity. That's what the Spirit is saying to us today. So why do we still see generational iniquity visited on people? Well, first of all, not everyone has become a partaker of the new covenant. So lots of people are suffering from visited generational iniquity. But what about a people who have entered the new covenant, believers? We see some of them still suffering from this visited generational iniquity. Well, here's what I've come to understand. Sometimes God's grace is just so great, and his plan is that he sovereignly removes the generational visited iniquity, he just removes it. I experienced that grace concerning drugs. It was just like some people struggle. I didn't struggle. Just he removed it. He showed me it was bad, and I stopped. That was it. But what if your visited generational iniquity did not disappear when you received the Lord and entered into the new covenant? Well, sometimes in God's plan, you have to appropriate his power. It doesn't just come upon you without effort. I don't understand why, but sometimes it does. And in order to do that, you need to repent of going along with whatever that iniquity was and break the power of all the evil spirits that have gained power over you because of that iniquity and renew your mind so you don't habitually fall back into that iniquity. I had to do this with the visited generational iniquity of my attitude toward money. Like I said, my parents were communists, so they believed investing money was evil. You know, that's capitalism. Right? So when I got out of school and went to work and would have money, we would just spend. And Xerox, praise God, set into place a retirement plan that was not optional. I mean, part of it was optional. I always took the part that was optional. But there was half of it was not optional. It had to go into a retirement plan. It had to go into investment. And I praise God for that, because it wasn't until about maybe 9 years after I came to trust in the Lord that God dealt with me about this. And the way it happened was I had to make a choice of where the investments would be that were in my retirement plan. And I found myself like not wanting to make the choice. It was like, that's not spiritual. That's not, that's something I don't want to deal with. And all of a sudden I just woke up and I was like, why do I feel that way? And I realized that was my parents' attitude, same attitude. And I repented of it and broke it. So sometimes it happens that way. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Messiah redeemed us from the curse pronounced in the Torah by becoming cursed on our behalf. For the Tanakh says, everyone who hangs from a stake comes under a curse. Redeemed from the curse means the price has been paid to set you free from the destructive consequences of breaking God's laws. Everybody follow that? And what is the curse? The destructive consequences of sin, transgression, and iniquity, all three of them. And the Tanakh says this about a person about hanging on a tree, if you want to look it up, in Deuteronomy 21, verse 23, but we're not going to go there. So when Yeshua was hung on a stake, a cross, a tree, a pole, he was suffering enormous physical pain from the nails, from the beating, from the crown of thorns. We also need to understand he also came under God's curse. He was separated from God. Matthew 27, verse 46 records this. At about 3, Yeshua uttered a loud cry, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you deserted me? He wasn't in God's presence at that moment because he was suffering the penalty for sin, transgression, and all iniquity of all human beings for all time. Hard to, you can't even conceive of what that suffering must have been. But his sacrifice redeemed us from the curse pronounced in the Torah, from the consequences of breaking God's law. Meaning that by his sacrifices we can be set free from the consequences of our own sin and from the destructive consequences of our forebears' sins, transgressions, and iniquities. Isaiah 53, verse 6 says this, we all like sheep have gone astray, each of us turned to his own way, so Adonai has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Again, about 600 years before the time of Yeshua, Isaiah predicted the iniquity of us all would be laid on him. And by the way, I hope you can recognize the terminology here. This is very similar to the scapegoat. The scapegoat had the iniquity laid upon it and bore the iniquity. It wasn't about blood being poured out. He had to bear the iniquity away. Now, what I saw in this, and I hope you can receive this, is when Adonai laid on him our iniquity, he laid all of our iniquity on him, not just part of it. Not just the iniquity we get into for our own sin, but also the visited generational iniquity that has become our iniquity. And the iniquity we have been delivered from, or maybe we haven't been delivered from, that might have been, or maybe you know already, has been visited on your children or your grandchildren. Or maybe it came from your parents or grandparents, but you see it in your grandchildren. They can be delivered from this too, but I believe we need to pray for them and share some of these things with them so they understand why they behave these ways, why they have these ways of thinking and feeling, that it comes down through the family line and they don't have to continue to live with it. We can be set free from it. And I like to see this as it's almost like there's this flood of visited iniquity that comes down through the generations, right? And there's only one way, like Jeremiah said, in those days, that this can be broken. It's like a dam put up, the Messiah breaks the passing down of the iniquity and sends it away, takes it away. He takes it away. It doesn't fill up and overflow later. He takes it away. He diverts it so no longer can affect us. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for the iniquity you have already removed from each of us. How many have had iniquity removed since you became a believer? Yes, you know those attitudes you had, they're not there anymore, right? So let's just thank him. Thank you, Lord. That is a work of the Holy Spirit. a work of the revelation of truth. So I pray for all of us who are hearing this, Lord, I pray that you would reveal any more that we need to deal with, anything else. We talked about this on Yom Kippur, that iniquity is often secret. And that's why we have the 10 days of awe, because we don't see it. It's the log in our eye while we're trying to remove the speck from our brother's eye. And Lord, we understand now that some of that iniquity can be have been visited upon us from our forebears, parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, great-great-grandparents, who we don't even know. We don't know what they were like. We don't know what they did. We don't know what they didn't do. We don't even know their names. But Father, we pray you would reveal if there is that kind of iniquity in our lives. And Father, we also reveal if any of our iniquity is being visited on our children and our grandchildren. And any of you here have great-grandchildren. We pray that you would reveal that and we would put a stop to it, Father. You would put a stop. We take responsibility for any generational iniquity. This is called repentance by identification. We repent for the iniquity of our forebears. We repent for the iniquity of parents and grandparents and great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents. Even though it was theirs, it became ours. And we repent. We repent of our own iniquity. We repent for our children's sake. In Yeshua's name, we ask you to forgive us. Forgive us, O Lord. Bear our iniquity. Count Messiah's sacrifice, as it said in the verse we just read. Redeem us, O Lord. Redeem us. Redeem us as we appropriate this, Father. We thank you that your word says if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And so we receive your forgiveness, O God. And we renounce that iniquity. Let's just, if you know something, you know, if you have a bad temper, if you're prone to bitterness or drugs or alcohol or something, just renounce it right now. I stand against it. We stand against that iniquity right now. We renounce it with the words of our mouth. In the name of Yeshua. In the name of Yeshua. And now, in the power of the name that is above every name, the name at which every knee shall bow, we break the power of all the forces of Satan, of every evil spirit, of every demon that have gained any power over us through that visited generational iniquity. We break the power of that. We break the power of those spirits over us, and we declare it is broken. We will not be subject to them anymore. We ask for the gift of discerning of spirits, O Lord, that we could tell when they're trying to tempt us again, and we can stand again. We break the power of that iniquity. And in the name of Yeshua, we command those spirits to leave us and our children. We break that flow of generational iniquity that's coming down. Give our children and us the ability to see what these things are and to set us free from them. Give us the faith to resist. And then renew our minds, O God. Renew our minds to think the way you think. To think on things that are lovely and righteous and beautiful and wonderful. To think on things that are godly, to think on things that agree with your word, O Lord. And we thank you today for the power of your word. And we thank you that we are set free. When the Son sets free is what? Is free indeed. And the truth shall do what? So the truth shall set you free. And Yeshua said, I am the way and the what? The truth and the life. And we thank you today, Father, that your truth is setting us free. In Yeshua's awesome name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally
at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Winton Road, Rochester, New York, 14609, or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit the featuring Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.